what we teach now is whether we're trying to help a lot of guys get their ex back, but I help a lot of guys get the sex back in their relationship. And that's eventually where like we most of the people like really lean in is I'm like, most guys are trying to do things to get something from their wife. I'm going to go do the dishes. I'm going to take out the trash. I'm going to do all that stuff.
Transactional.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And women are bloodhounds, dude. They can smell that stuff from a mile away. Right. And so I realized I can't do this to get something from her. I need to do this because this is who I am.
Yo, yo, yo. Welcome to another episode of the Founder Podcast. Today, I am sitting in Orange County with Mr. Keith Yackey. What up, Keith?
Let's go, man. Welcome to the man cave, bro.
Oh, man. I am super excited to be in the man cave.
That's a good one.
So for those that don't know Keith, Keith is the man, the myth, the legend when it comes to relationships. He runs what's called the Married Game. So marriedgame.com, where he teaches successful entrepreneurs, people that are doing incredible things in life, how to get their game right with their spouse, with their wives.
That's right, man.
Man, this is an important subject.
Well, for a guy that his wife doesn't want to be intimate with him anymore, this is like the only thing he thinks about.
Oh, my goodness.
Right?
I mean, there could not be a better truth spoken.
Yeah,
I could say
that's what we do in the man cave here. We spit truth.
I love it. I love it. Yeah. So Keith, man, so you are like I've heard a lot about you from. I mean, I got referred to you by some people that I super respect. On top of that, you're an incredible speaker on stage. You go around sharing the truth.
Yeah.
About relationships. So tell us a little bit about yourself, a little background on yourself.
Well, you know, we're talking about Married Game and we're talking about this thing. So before I met my wife, I had been with hundreds of women. So I understood short-term game. I understood short-term attraction. And I wasn't actually even wanting to settle down until I met my current wife. And I was like, dude, if I was going to settle down, this would be the one.
Right.
And so I asked her to be my girlfriend on a Monday Night Football.
So she was watching football with you.
We were at the game,
okay,
closing down the bar with Mike Tirico and John Gruden.
Okay.
And we had had some libations, and I said, you know, I didn't know I wanted a girlfriend, but if I was to have a girlfriend, I'd want her to be like you. Do you want to be my girlfriend? And she goes, you're drunk. And I go, maybe, but the truth is, I'd like for you to be my girl. She goes, let's do it. Let's do it. So that was that was a little over 12 years ago.
Okay.
And
at this point, you'd already been married.
Been married before and divorced.
And had three kids?
Three kids. Yeah, been married, divorced. I was married like at 18 years old earlier. So I was like, you found the one, let's go. And had three kids, and then that didn't work out. Spent a few years sowing my oats, and then I met her. And I was like, oh, okay, this is different. I like you a lot.
How old were you at this time?
12 years. I just turned 45, so let's 33. Call me 33. Yeah. And she was 25.
Okay.
So I was like, all right, let's do this. Well, 5 years into it, we were moving into our dream home. I had some funnels that worked really well for me. And we're moving into our dream home, and I was at a mastermind. And I was bragging to some of my buddies, like, dude, life's going great. Me and Jesse are doing amazing. Life's going great. Only to have her FaceTime me and say, hey, I'm going to help you move in, but I'm not staying.
Mm. And were you married at this time?
The way we looked at it, yes. That's, you know, yes. Technically not marriage certificate, but
right.
That our mind
you
was.
You were committed.
It was more than just like my long-term girlfriend. Like, you're right. It. We're it forever.
Yeah.
And so she goes, I'm not staying. And you run your business, you come home and talk about your business, and then you fall asleep on the couch.
Mm.
And if I'm being really honest with you, and I know this is going to sting, I believe my life would be better without you in it.
Mm. How long ago was this?
7 years ago.
Oof.
And this is almost seven and a half.
Dude, I feel the gut punch from that sentence.
Like, bro, it was like, okay. And she's like, so I know you're probably going to try and figure out how not. She goes, but I've been thinking this for a really long time.
Oh.
And no matter what I try and tell you to do, I'm clearly not a priority to you. Your business is way more important. Your friends are more important. And we're done.
Mm.
And it was all. And then so she did help me move in. We got everything unpacked, everything, and then I loaded up her stuff and my daughter's stuff into a smaller U-Haul, and I watched them drive down the road.
And how old's your daughter at this point?
2. Yeah. And it was almost, it didn't hit me right in that moment, but it was almost like, it feels like it is because I'm looking back, but right in that first week or two, it became very clear to me I'm the problem. And it was almost like simultaneously I realized, well, if I'm the problem, I'm the solution. And so I hired 3 coaches, you know, as any good dude, you're like, hey, I got a problem, I got to hire a coach. I hired 3 different coaches, right? And I'm like, okay, how do I, and they really helped me understand the psychology of what I did wrong and where I went wrong and actually how I could get her back. Even though I didn't even actually believe that they went through what I went through, because, like, you know, when you go through something like that, the pain is so real and so visceral. And when they're explaining it, I'm like, you may have went through it, but I don't know if you went through it, but what you're telling me to do makes so much sense, because trying to get somebody back is very counterintuitive, because I did everything wrong. I'm like, dude, I wrote her music. I put PowerPoint presentations together. I'm calling her and crying and making myself look really pathetic, right, and only pushing desperate. Her away, totally desperate. And then I realized, dude, this isn't working, and you need
PowerPoint presentations.
PowerPoint presentation.
Dude, tell me about that. Yeah. Okay, hold on. Time out.
Yeah.
PowerPoint presentation. First of all, I gotta hear what was on this PowerPoint presentation.
Just pictures of us, like trying to bring back old memories, you know, and
just sappy.
Oh, dude. Bro, I'm singing Bruno Mars. I'm singing I'm pulling my guitar out. I used to be a musician, and I'm singing songs and dubbing it over. It was like a bad mixtape from when we were kids, dude. Yeah.
Yummy.
Yeah, right. And so she was just like, dude, you need to stop. Like, this is
pathetic.
This is pathetic, and you're a joke. And then I was like, yeah, you're right. I am. So I realized that if I'm the problem, I'm the solution. The solution is I need to become the most attractive. I realized the punchline was she's no longer attracted to me. And a lot of guys, when they think about being attractive, they think, oh, you got to have muscles and abs and all this. And I realize it's so much more than that. It's attraction is people lean in and go, hey, I want to know more. I like being around you. And she was repelled. She was like, you know, and there's reasons. Like when we first got together, I was 185 pounds of tiger meat wrapped in barbed wire, dude. Like, I was fit, lean, ready to go. When she left, I had ballooned up to like 245.
Yes, 60 pounds.
60 pounds of just of good eating. You know what I mean? And I'm like, this is your fault. I'm kidding. No, it wasn't. It was mine. I kept eating. And she's just like, you know, I'm not selling for this anymore. Like, this is not what you promised us. And it was like the ultimate bait and switch. When I look back, you know, it's as humiliating as that is to say, I was like the ultimate bait and switch artist. So I realized I have to become attractive, but I have to do it for me. Because, like, I think women, they can sense this energy. And so, like, what we teach now is whether we're trying to help a lot of guys get their ex back, but I help a lot of guys get the sex back in their relationship. And that's eventually where, like, we most of the people, like, really lean in. Is I'm like, most guys are trying to do things to get something from their wife. I'm gonna go do the dishes. I'm gonna take out the trash. I'm gonna do all that stuff.
Transactional.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And women are bloodhounds, dude. They can smell that stuff from a mile away.
Right.
And so I realized I can't do this to get something from her. I need to do this because this is who I am. And I need to become, and I knew what that meant. I knew what it meant to become the most attractive version of me. I was not new to female interaction, and I had realized, dude, I messed this up, and I need to get back to being who I am, the one she fell in love with.
So what'd you do?
Like, specifically?
Yeah, dude, give us the game plan, man. All of us guys are over here taking notes.
Yeah, right.
So
right.
We're like, yep, been there. Yep, been in on the transactional.
Yeah.
Right, been there when the wife not necessarily says I'm done, but it's like, hey, you know, there's a lot about you that I'm not attracted to.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, we've all been there.
Well, I'll frame it with how I frame it now, because it will be easier for us to go, oh, check. Okay. I'm not doing that. I'm not doing that. I am doing that. I'm not doing that. But it's not how I thought about it in the time. You know, looking back, I was able to frame it up and go, okay, what did I actually do? And so that's where I came up with the 5 dials. So I'll just explain it in our 5 dial system.
Let's do it.
So I realized that not only her, but every woman is looking at their man and going, okay, I am they're judging us by these five things. These are the five major criteria that a woman is basically consciously or unconsciously judging her husband on.
Yeah.
And either gaining attraction or losing attraction based on these things. So the first thing is the parenting dial. And she looked at me and my wife said, I feel like a single parent. And I feel, I don't even want to have a second kid with you because you were so bad with the first one. Hmm. And I had already had three other kids. And I had changed plenty of diapers with the first three ones.
Right.
I changed like maybe four diapers in 2 years with my now 9-year-old daughter, Jovi. And she's like, I don't even want to go out on girls' night because I'm not even sure you can handle our kid. Like, what an indictment to what a POS I was. You know what I mean? So I was like, okay. And then, but a lot of guys are like, is it really that big of a deal? And I go, well, dude, she's hardwired to birth these babies and to make sure that they survive and then thrive.
Right.
And
I mean, that's their number one concern.
And they're built for it. Like, we would be shocked if they didn't think that. You know what I mean? And
the same way that we're hardwired to solve problems, to provide, to do all those different things,
right? Kill buffalo.
Yeah.
We want to kill buffalo. They want to raise babies.
Right.
And so one of the things that I realized was that the truth is that women love their kids more than their husband 100% of the time.
Mm.
And here's why I know that. Because moms divorce dads. They don't divorce kids.
Mm.
And so whether we like it or not, that's the facts.
Right.
And so I realized she's looking at me and going like, do you care about this thing that we made together? Do you care? And are you invested in this? And if you're not and you're neglecting this baby, you're neglecting a part of me.
Right.
And so I realized I got like a 0 out of 10 on that particular score. Right. And so it was a real huge turnoff for her. So she's like, all right, this guy is a total loser dad.
Right.
And she wasn't wrong. So that was the first thing. I was like, you know what? I need to actually show up. And why am I not showing up? Like, this needs to just change now. And so she moved away to California.
Where were you living at the time?
Vegas.
Okay.
So I lived like three doors down from Mr. T.
Hmm.
Okay. So like having that guy as a neighbor is like, it's kind of a fun talking point. But with that being said, I was like, okay, well, every weekend I'm either going to go there or I'm going to pay for her to come here. And when she's here, I'm going to like be all in as a dad with her. I'm not going to be like on my phone, like, you know, yeah, I do. I was like all in. I've got some of the best memories. And then I would pay for her mom to bring her up. And so then I would hang out with her mom. And so all these things I'd missed before, barely talked to her family, barely, like I just was in my thing. And a lot of entrepreneurs get that. They're like, tunnel vision. I'm building my thing.
I'm out killing buffalo.
And shocked that that's not enough.
Right.
Most guys are like, dude, I provide, I protect, I produce. Like, what's the problem here? Where's my... And it's like, you don't get it, man. That's only one of the dials. So I was majorly messing up this parenting dial, which is so embarrassing. Because it's like, you would think I would get that. And most dudes listening to this, they'd be like, okay, I'm nailing that dial, Keith. Like, move on.
Right.
But that was a big one for me. So that was dial number one.
I can relate with that, you know, like...
Really?
Yeah, I mean, I have five kids, you know, and I think I'm a good dad most of the time, but there's definitely times where it's just like she's the only one involved, right? Like I'm out traveling, I'm working, I'm killing the buffalo, I'm doing these different things, I'm building an empire or whatever it may be, and she's running into Little League baseball and dance practice and everything else, and then I come home and like the last thing I want to do is be engaged.
Yeah.
Right? Like it's like I want to decompress or whatever else. And so I mean there's definitely been times where I've been more engaged or less engaged over our, I mean, me and my wife have been married for 18 years. Our oldest is 17.
Nice.
Right? And so like there's definitely been these different times where that relationship is stretched thin and I haven't been the best dad.
Yeah.
And so I definitely can see why that's such an important dial.
Here's a telltale sign if a guy's kind of messing this thing up without even knowing he's messing it up, is when he looks at his kids like he's babysitting them.
Mm.
You guys have seen this? Mm-hmm. And my wife's like, you're not babysitting our daughter.
Right.
You're her dad.
Right.
And you spending time with her is not like, wow, well done. You're her dad. How do you not get this?
You shouldn't even
like,
be praised for it. Right?
Exactly. Like that's exactly the minimum. Right. Yeah, it's like, you need a cookie? Like, what are you doing, dude?
Right.
So I really jacked that one up big time. All right, second dial. Most guys, if they would rate themselves on a 1 to 10, they might be like, I'm a 7, 8, or 9. Very few guys are like the 1 or 2 like I was. But some guys are, but we'll see. You know, they get to rate themselves. The second dial was what we call the partner dial. I kind of just call that like the best friend dial. How connected does your wife feel with you on a friendship level? And most guys are failing this in a major way. And they're like, they don't really care what their wife's saying. And they're like, oh, you're talking about your sister and your mom again. That's lame. But they'll put on a good face and thinking, if I put in 15 minutes of talk time here, maybe I'll get a few minutes upstairs. And this whole transactional energy comes around. And people know, dude, if you actually are listening or care or leaning in, like they know. And women really know because that's their thing. You know what I mean? They're really dialed in on that. And it's like, is this guy just talking to me? You're like, uh-huh, babe. Yeah, right. Oh, sure. Or is he really like my partner in life? And it shows up another way too. And this is where I was really messed up. My wife just said, I feel more alone being married to you than if I was single.
Mm.
And I was like, oh, dude, you're not wrong. Like, she wasn't wrong.
Right.
Like, I was dead to rights on all of these things. So it's like, when I realized I was the problem, I was like, these are actually easy things to fix if I would just like lean into this. And so, for example, usually I get off around 5 every night and I'll be like, hey, let's go on a family date night. Let's all go out to dinner and let's leave around 5:15. It gives me time to come home, kind of, you know, get stuff, you know, straightened out and then let's head out. And I'd be the guy that would get home at 5, tinker around till like 5:14 and 45 seconds and then come strolling out like, I'm ready. You guys ready to rock and roll? Like, let's go. And she'd be like, man, it kind of would have been really helpful for you to help me with our daughter, get her ready, maybe even pack up the car, like be helpful.
Jeez, dude, you're hitting me just right below the shorts. All. Yeah, oh, jeez.
That's what I'm here to do, man. That's what I'm here to do.
Keep going.
So it, I realized.
I'm not sure I want my wife to listen to this podcast. She'd be like, yep.
Yeah, well, wait till we get to dial 4 and 5. But so I realized I wasn't even showing up like a best friend. And she would tell me, she's like, I don't even tell you most of the things that go on in my life because I feel like you don't even actually care.
Mm.
And who wants to be in partnership with somebody who doesn't actually listen, doesn't actually care, doesn't actually lean in, doesn't actually ask, hey, you know, we talk about showing up with curiosity. Like, curiosity is a superpower. Hey, I'm curious about you. Tell me about this. Hey, why did you do that? Well, you know, when you were in school, what was this like? When you moved here, what was that emotion like? What did you go through? Her dad was a rocket. He was on tour with Motley Crue, right? Wow. He's got a couple silver records. Like, the guy's done some cool stuff. She's like, you don't even care. Her uncle was the manager for Motorhead, which is one of the greatest rock bands of all time. Who actually, that mirror is from Lemmy, the guy who the singer of Motorhead. And she's like, you don't even know really anything about me.
Mm.
And in fact, she goes, I feel like a walking private part.
Jeez. Did like you just feel like she was just kicking you in the teeth?
I felt.
Because I feel for you.
Yeah. Yeah, dude. We're talking. This is the funniest thing. 7 years ago when she left me, all my best friends, like in Martel and Vargas, these guys were around at that time.
Yeah.
And they were like, she's not wrong. Like, you are that guy. Like, you're a great friend and you're doing great things in business. But, dude, like, we can kind of. When Jesse calls us, we're like, yeah, he's those things. And so it was like this thing where it was like this big awakening for me where I was like, dude, I really actually am the problem here. And this is now going to be my second divorce. And I'm at fault here. So like it was a really, yeah, it was a kick in the teeth for me, dude. Keep going.
I want to hear more about the kicks because there's three more dials,
Three more dials, yeah. Okay, so a guy can rate himself. Scale of 1 to 10. How good of a partner would your wife actually call you to tell you about something that was important to her, or would she call her best friend or mom first?
Mm, dude, and the same token, if something important's happening in business, are you first calling your wife?
Exactly.
Right? Like that's actually one of the gauges I use. And a lot of times it's not the case, and I got to check myself. Like,
yeah.
Like, why am I not excited to tell this to my wife.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. Probably because she's like, cool. You've told me about everything 100 times and you never ask me.
And by the way, my wife's name is Andrea. She got after me the other day for only referring to her as my wife on the podcast.
Okay. So, all right. Andrea. Shout out to Andrea. Well done.
Hopefully you're not watching this podcast.
But your best friend is. No, I'm kidding. All right. So the third dial. This one, every guy's gonna be like, that's me. I'm good at this. The producer dial. We are built to go out, kill buffalo, bring back the pelts.
Dude, I'm a 12 out of 10.
Yeah, you're a 12 out of 10, dude. Right, so it's like, and most guys are like, hey, you know what? I'm doing pretty well. Now, here's the interesting thing, is with this dial, I was a 10 out of 10. I was crushing. I was creating. We were moving into a beautiful home. Like, life was good in that regard. And guys say one of two things. I'm doing this for my family, which, of course, I said. I'm doing all this for you. And she's like, except you're not here. So, and you're doing it for your ego. And I actually don't even want any of this if I don't get you. Mm. I wanted you, but you're giving me all this. And this I can't snuggle with this. Mm. I wanted to snuggle with you.
Man, this is one-on-one counseling for me.
Yeah,
appreciate
here we go.
This.
I like this. Well, we're not even to the good stuff yet.
Keep it going.
So well done,
going.
Chris. Okay, so there was the one guy that we become the workaholic and we say, we're doing this for you. And then there's the other guy, which I kind of fit both. My business was kind of it wasn't on autopilot, but it was, I had a team, I had crew, and we were doing multiple 7 figures. So I was like, I kind of got this, and I kind of started taking my foot off the gas in myself, letting myself go. And she's like, you kind of lost your ambition and your drive. Like, yeah, we've got this thing, but I know you. When you're really into something and you're really on the gas, this isn't you.
Right.
Right, and so I like to say, hey, women don't want to have cloth seats and one-bedroom apartments forever. So there's got to be this ambition and drive to go, but it's also got to be like, we're doing this for you, and I'm bringing you along, and we're doing this together. It's like you and me versus the world, as opposed to I'll go out and kill the buffalo. And there's almost an entitlement for men when they do really bring home great buffalo steaks and great buffalo pelts. They're like, there you go, now you should give me everything I want. And she's like, yeah, but it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. So I would encourage a guy to be like, on a scale of 1 to 10, where are you at? Like, how resourceful are you? It does, because it matters to a woman. She wants to feel safe and secure. She doesn't want to be broke. She doesn't [S2] Right. [S1] Want to be like, she doesn't want to see her man stressed about money all the time, because then he's not focused on her and like bringing this abundance and peace to her. So that's first three dials. Any feedback on that so far,
Chris?
Oh,
man. Like I said, I feel like this is a personal counseling session for me. But yeah, man, if I'm going to grade myself on the first three dials, well, number three, I'm feeling fantastic about.
Okay, good.
Like I said, 12 out of 10, maybe even a 15 out of 10.
Okay.
You know,
I like it.
I got plenty of buffalo coming in at home. I feel like I'm the provider. I'm doing awesome. You know, as far as like being the father that I need to be, or being the partner that I need to be, there's some room for improvement. I'm not necessarily want to disclose where I feel like I'm at on a number scale to the whole world, but man. Yeah, it's this is great. I think, you know, and it's interesting because conceptually, whatever the subject is, you know, most of us know a lot of these things, right? Yeah. Like what you're saying isn't new, right?
Yeah.
But the way that you're breaking it down and into like we operate off of like, all right, here's a 5-step.
Yeah.
Structure, right? Or a framework to be able to go. And men especially respond to frameworks.
We love that.
We love frameworks. So you putting this down into a five-step dial framework is huge. And it really helps me like, yeah, man, where am I at as far as being the present father that needs to take care of my children and be an equal partner in the relationship and then treat my wife like a best friend, you know? And so, man, I think this is great stuff.
Yeah, I always say like, you know, feelings are fleeting, but frameworks are forever.
Yeah.
And so anytime I can put myself up against a framework and go, okay, where do you stand, big guy? Like, where are you really at? So that leads us into the fourth dial. And this fourth dial and fifth dial are usually where guys really fall off the cliff really bad.
Man.
So the fourth dial is the player dial. When you think of a player, I'm not talking about Mr. One Night Stand guy. I'm talking about, to quote the great American poet, Cyndi Lauper, girls just want to have fun. most guys stop truly dating their wife, like genuinely being fun. They, for me, I went from svelte, strong, athletic body where like I would be walking down the boardwalk and women would be like, you look great, to 245, like, dude, maybe men do get pregnant. You know what I mean? Like, wow, that's the emoji. The emoji's after that guy. So just the player of like being understanding, being playful and banter and flirting and understanding. The guy that she fell in love with, and here's the cool thing about getting the intimacy like roaring back again in your bedroom is you're her type. She already said, I'm attracted to you in the beginning, or she wouldn't have said, I do. She wouldn't have been into you. And most guys are like, dude, in the beginning of the marriage, dude, the bedroom was on fire. And they know what that peak of possibility is. And then now they're living in this pit. And a way for a guy to know that he's in this pit and he's seeing this huge gap is she no longer initiates. Mm-hmm. This is how a guy can know, like, hey, I'm really, we'll look at the dials, but just know this. If she's stopped initiating, if she's stopped enthusiastically participating, and guys know what I'm talking about, she's not just laying there and going, hey, you got 4 minutes until the bachelorette comes on, hurry up, you know what I mean? Like, do your thing, I'm not here, but you can use my body. Guys hate that. We want to be wanted. We want to be desired.
Absolutely.
And it's like, well, are you wantable? Okay, well, the player is the guy he's the world's resident expert on understanding his wife's love language. He understands how she operates. He is still dating her for fun. He's not dating her out of obligation. Like, well, the church says we're supposed to hang out, so we should do that. Or the counselor said, you know, we're supposed to spend more time together, so I guess I'll come home early one night and, you know, let's get on with it. Women don't want that. So I always ask guys this. I go, when's the last time you took your wife on a date? And usually guys are like, I don't know, 6 weeks ago, 8 weeks ago. And I go, okay, cool, what did you do? Like, well, you know, we went to Home Depot to pick up some parts for the house and then swang through Chick-fil-A. It was a good night out. And I'm like, bro, you don't get it. This is why your wife's not clawing at you and saying, hey, the kids are down. You better meet me up in the bedroom in 5 minutes. I'm going to be ready for you. The reason why that went away is because he's no longer playful. Right. He's got like a broomstick broke off in his arse, and she's like, dude, you're serious all the time. You're no longer fun. We never go on dates. And so I always go like this. Okay, let's just set a new standard. What if you set this standard? Every guy had that crush in high school, right? And unless you married her, you remember her, and you're like, okay.
I married my crush.
You married your crush. Okay, well, my crush was Kristen Bennett. She was the head cheerleader, and she sat next to me in algebra in ninth grade, right? I always wanted to get with Kristen. And I imagine right now, and for the guys watching and listening, dude, imagine right now the crush in high school. You're single, and she reaches out to you on social media and says, hey, looks like life's pretty good. It would be great to connect. You're like, cool, it's a date. I'll pick you up at such and such night. How would you show up to that date? Dude, you'd be doing your push-ups before. You wouldn't be wearing your dad's, you know, sport coat that's three sizes too big. You'd be smelling good. You'd be planning. Okay, we're going to go here. We're going to go here. You'd be putting a lot of effort and intention. Why? You want to get laid. You want action. And so it's like, well, but you don't do any of that for your wife, and you expect it just to happen? Like, you know better than that. Right. Nobody says, I'm going to get abs and biceps without working out. Why do you expect her to fawn all over you if you're not putting in any effort? So that's what the player dial is. The player dial is, wait, I've got to keep things, I've got to stay in shape and be the best version of me for me, and that's the standard that I set. And she looks and goes, He's still as hot as he was in high school. In fact, he's even hotter because now he's got white hair, and he's rich, and he's fun, and he's playful, and dude, he's such a good dude. Most wives can't say that about their husband anymore. Right. So that's the player dial.
I like that. You know, that one, it's interesting. I think sometimes I would classify myself as a 10 and other times as a 2.
Yeah.
It kind of depends. So that's one thing that I've gotten pretty right in my relationship with my wife, Andrea, that I don't know, it was like 7 years ago, maybe 8 years ago, I decided, all right, we're going to date every week, right? Nice. And so we go without fail every Friday night. And if for whatever reason we have a football game or something that night, then we swap it. We do it on a Saturday.
Nice. But
I would say we hit probably 95% of our weeks. So that's pretty good.
Yeah.
But there's definitely aspects that you're saying as far as like, you know, having like bringing my A game, trimming up my beard just right, or whatever it may be, right? Like wearing the nicest clothes instead of wearing a backwards hat and like some sweats, and hitting up Home Depot or whatever.
It's effort. When they see when you put in effort and you smell. I mean, this is some basic stuff, but some guys are like, dude, like you smell. Like, why don't you wear deodorant? Or why don't you trim your nails? Or why is your breath stink? Or don't you do your hair? And here's a concept that we have in Mary Game. We want to be the catch of the county. The catch of the county means this. If for some reason your wife decided, either she died or she wanted to leave you or she did leave you, would you have 100 women at your front door saying, how do I be the next Mrs. You? That's a standard. That is a high standard. That guy who lives by that standard, or at least has that in mind and is aware of it, that dude is getting a lot of action in the bedroom. Why? Because I talk about sex and intimacy and connection like this so much is because, first of all, a guy understands. He goes, I'm either getting it or I'm not. Or 85% of dudes are not happy with the quantity or quality of intimacy in their marriage. So I know in every room I walk into, 8.5 of those dudes aren't like
happy.
They're like, keep talking, I'm listening. But sometimes they'll like be like, oh, I don't need to listen to some dude teach me how to do that. And like, well, the good carpenter of Nazareth taught us what? What's your fruit? Look at every tree and bear everything off of what kind of fruit does it bear. And so if you don't like the fruit in your life, most guys get mad at the fruit. Oh, fruit, you should be better. And it's like, no, dude, look at the root, bro. The root is unhealthy. The soil is unhealthy.
Now you're speaking my language. I don't know if you know this, but I love trees.
Really?
I'm a big tree guy.
You said that when you mentioned that when you watched the tree out there, when you look at the tree outside.
Yeah. So I have 23 acres.
Where did the tree fetish start?
Actually, being a hobby farmer. Right?
Okay.
So I have a hobby farm. It's just what I like to do in my off time, right? Yeah. Like my wife loves being out in the gardens, and we have 2.5 acres of yard, right? And then so flower beds and everything. And then we have another 20 acres of trees. We have cherry trees and black walnut trees. I have 9,000 cherry trees and different things like that. And so I think that trees actually teach us more about leadership and about like life than pretty much anything. And the what you're talking about as far as fruit, like this is actually something I teach that the goal isn't to produce fruit. The goal is to be a tree that can bear fruit, right? Mm-hmm. To take care of that, because fruit is only under ideal circumstances, and we can't always control the circumstance, right? Yeah. So the weather can be bad or whatnot that can destroy the fruit. And if we're so focused on the fruit, we'll just chop the tree down, right? Because it didn't produce what we wanted versus actually taking care of the thing that it just being able to produce. Yeah, so man. I'm a big, like I said, you're speaking my language.
Yeah, well, I just, because guys get so mad, they're like, why can't I get this right? It's like, you're not a tree that can bear fruit, man. Your roots are jacked up. The soil is jacked up. Something is off. So let's focus there. Let's look there. And this player dial, usually a lot of guys are like, dude, I'm not very fun anymore. I'm not very playful. Defensiveness. Guys get so defensive. And it's like, dude, nobody likes being around a defensive person. Like it's so annoying and it's exhausting, but most dudes get really defensive.
Yeah, for sure.
And it's like, okay, so well, that's the opposite. Fun is the opposite of trauma too. If you notice, laughing is it's the only involuntary thing that we do. People who listen to a comedian, they don't go, oh yeah, that should be funny. I should be laughing. Ha ha ha. No, it's
instant.
I can't stop it. It's like uncontrollable. But a person doesn't laugh when they're in traumatic situations. It's the opposite. So it's like, I failed this miserably. Dude, I got like a zero. I stopped going out with my wife. I stopped taking her out. I was just like, nah, I'm busy. I got my thing to do. Like you, maybe later, maybe one day. And she's like, dude, there's no promise of tomorrow, Keith. Like, are you going to get it together or not? So this is a big dial that a lot of guys, congrats for you for being a 10 most of the time and not a 2.
I wouldn't say a 10 most of the time. I, like I said, I swing back and forth.
Okay,
like,
yeah.
Like there's some things in that dial that I am a 10, right? Yeah. Like consistently go out on a date, I'm pretty dang good at that, right? Like those are some things, but there's definitely other things that I'm like, you know, like I don't care to impress my wife in certain areas.
Yeah.
She'd be like, why don't you shave your nose hairs? You know, just like stuff. I'm just like, who cares? Like, you're my wife, you know, like you're around me all the time. Why do I need to impress you with my nose hairs? But yet, if I was trying to be the catch of the town, you know, that thing would be well shaved and trimmed up and, you know, just crap like that. But it just triggers some of these things that, it is interesting how we let things go lax.
Yeah, it's you know, what I've noticed is that women, they want to be able to sit back and in a room and be like so proud that that's their man.
Right.
The woman that's like, I got him, that I'm his. That's a woman that shows up with a heart to say, I want to please you, I want to serve you. Dude, when you love a woman, her love back to you is it's exponential. It's like, it's, we look at it like deposits and credits, you know what I mean? And most guys, they're kind of afraid. Well, first of all, a lot of guys have been, let me get into the power. So that's the player dial. Okay. So I think I'm going to get into power dial here in a second. But the player dial is this dial where you ask yourself, like, are you really that wantable? If it wasn't your wife and this was how you showed up for any woman, would any woman be like, wow, I can't wait to hang out with you? And most guys, unfortunately, the answer is, no.
What's interesting, so I have a friend, I won't share his name, but he went through a divorce probably a couple years ago. Mm. And it's interesting because most guys that go through divorces, you see a transformation take place afterwards, right? So they go from fat, overweight, not taking care of themselves, not impressing their wife, to all of a sudden, I got to be back market ready.
Yeah.
Right?
And they ready. That's a great way of putting it.
Right? Like they go and they start working out, taking care of themselves. It's like, dude, why didn't you do that beforehand? Yeah. Why didn't you want to be market ready for your wife, the one that you had invested 15, 20 years, that you have 4 or 5 kids with or whatever it may be, right? And it's so intriguing that, like, us as men, we literally nothing clicks until it's gone.
Yeah. That's so true, dude. There's a thing that I am, I don't know if anybody's talking about it, but I like talking about it, and I think you've actually said it better than I've even said it. And I'll tell you my original theory and thesis, and then I'm going to tell you why I think yours is better, or yours defines and describes what I've been trying to say way better.
Pray tell.
So when a man is single, he has options. And what causes women to show up as their best version of themselves is because they realize they are one of many options. All you have to do is watch The Bachelor or The Bachelor, and everybody's vying for that rose. And so he becomes the chooser, all right, because he has many options. But once somebody says, hey, I do, and we're in this, it's monogamous, it's you and me, there is no more options. Like, that's it. But, and so the key to short-term attraction and why people will vie for a man's attention is he's market ready and he has options. But when he says, I do, and they become one, that lever is gone. It's entirely gone. It's like, why do I need to shave my nose hair? Like, I've already got you, right? And most guys look at the relationship like, I won, it's finished. It's like, no, you just stepped into the starting blocks. It's even harder now to keep that attraction firing. So what is the lever now? The lever, I've always said, is you have it. The lever is perception of options. Not that you're on dating sites, not that you're trying to hook up with anybody, but it's you stay market ready. Mm. So I'm gonna adopt that from
dude,
you.
Trademark it, baby.
Yeah, market cheers. Ready. Because here's what happens is if somebody come up to like your wife, not your wife, but a guy's wife, and goes, hey, do you think he's cheating on you? And she goes, who would want him? He's not market ready. Mm. And so she goes, I've actually settled being with him. Nobody else would. Well, I've got the dog. I've got the runt of the litter. She's not sitting across the room going, I'm that guy's wife.
Right.
And that is the key to being a player, dude. So staying market ready.
So it's interesting. This is also similar to the concept of like considering death, right? Mm. Like, I don't know if you've ever thought about it this way, but like for me, the easiest way to take advantage of today or a relationship in the moment, or really just embrace my blessings for what they are, is to ponder on death, right?
Sounds like Marcus Aurelius.
Right? So like when you go and you consider death, like if I were to die tomorrow, would I be happy with what I'm doing right now or whatever? It's the same. It's not that I want to die. It's not that I want a divorce or I want to be available to all these women, right? Like same type of concept. Yeah. But if that were to happen, would I be satisfied with what I'm doing today?
Yeah.
Right. And so it's the same exact concept. You don't necessarily have to put yourself through death or put yourself through divorce or put yourself back on the market.
Yeah.
Right. But you just have to remind yourself that like that's the other side, right? I could be dead tomorrow, or I could be back on the market and be fat and unattractive and everything else. So like how do I take advantage of where I'm at today to really capitalize on the relationship that I have?
You know, I love that analogy. I think that's so perfect. And it what was coming to me while you were saying that was like, people need to stop living in fantasy and they need to start living in reality.
Right.
The reality is you could be dead tomorrow. We have friends. How old are you?
39.
I'm 45. I've got dudes that, plenty of people that in my life that are my age that are gone.
Yeah. I almost died earlier this year. Well, 10 months ago. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. I'll tell you about it in a bit. But
okay. Wow. Yeah. All right. So you've been faced with this. Like you're face to face with death and you go, okay, my wife's brother unexpectedly passed away just 18 months ago.
Oh my goodness.
He was 31. So it hit our family in a very serious way. We're like,
wild.
Dude. And it made my wife go, I'm going to do the podcast with you. I'm going to die. What does it matter? Who cares? Why don't I just get on? And what I can tell people will really actually help their existence now, I'm done being afraid. I'm going to serve people now rather than, you know, try and protect whatever ego I have. So it's moving from fantasy, which, dude, I was so delusional thinking my wife would never leave me. But if you looked at reality, it's like, why would she stay?
Right.
And that was the reality was like the frying pan across the face is like, oh, dude. And most guys, if their wife were to leave them right now, they'd be shocked and they have no idea. And a lot of guys who listen to our podcast or listen to when I'm a guest on other podcasts, they're like, dude, you brought reality to me. Like, I'm actually not the catch of the county. I'm actually not wantable. Dude, and this is what I told Jesse after about maybe a month and a half of her being gone, and I realized, okay, dude, this was your fault. I started working on myself, getting in shape, doing my thing, and doing whatever. I actually like sent her a video. And because we were still co-parenting and we were talking, but I said, I'm actually proud of you. You should have left me. And secondly, and I didn't realize this one would be so weighty, this next thing I said, because I was just, you know, spitting from the heart. I said, it's kind of a shame that some other woman's actually going to cash in on all your hard work. And I meant it because I felt bad. I'm like, dude, you woke me up.
Right.
And now I'm being that guy. Like I knew I was back in that state. I was like, oh, I know who to be. And I was like, and it was like, you did all the work. Like you're the one who like sowed all this and tilled this ground and planted the seed and watered it. And some other person's going to come through and like
eat all the harvest.
Yeah. And then I'm just like, I feel bad. I feel horrible. But thank you. You know what I mean? Like it was like, I was deeply I had deep gratitude for it. So that's the player dial. Just be wantable.
Love it.
All right.
Love it. Hold on. Timeline.
Yeah.
So how long? So obviously you made it work with her.
Yeah.
How long were you guys separated?
About 5 or 6 months.
About 5 or 6 months.
Yeah. And she had, dude, she, after about a month or 2 months, she had found somebody new. Like it, there was no, I was out of the picture. This was not, there.
It, she was it's done.
Done. Like so done. It was. And so people are like.
The only thing you shared at that point was a child.
That's it. That's it. And so it's I still find it really comical. I got to tell you a story. She comes back and she's been back about 6 weeks. We still hadn't been intimate. She still had boxes packed still in her closet. Ooh. So I'm so insecure about this.
Like, you're walking on needles.
I'm like, what is going on? So we're laying in bed and her foot touches mine. And the story I'm about ready to tell you, it might sound unbelievable to hear on your ears. It's just as unbelievable coming off my lips, but it happened to me, so I'm going to tell it to you anyway. As soon as her foot touched me, I started crying, like deeply, like, you know, really crying. And I was like, dude, this is as low as I've ever, even though I got her back, the hugs were obligatory. The kisses were like, okay, like we're working with some coaches. And I'm like, they're like, all right, write 10 good things about your partner. And she's like, I can only come up with one. And he's like, okay, well, what is it? And she's like, he's trying. Like, that was it. I'm 6 weeks into this journey back. She's like, he's trying. And I'm like, oh, dude, she's beautiful. She's amazing. She's a great mom. And I'm like, I can fill out 10 easy. And she's like, I got one. And I was like, okay, so this isn't going good. And this isn't exactly, because you think you got her back, but, right. But is she really back? And in that moment, I feel God speak to me. This is why it might sound weird to people, but he said, I'm going to use you to help millions of men solve this same problem.
Love it.
And I was like, you got the wrong house. Because I haven't solved the problem. I'm like, dude, there's boxes. We don't even hang out. Like, it's like this, you've got the, and I genuinely was like, I was so humbled by it. So to see where we're at here, having helped hundreds of guys and having thousands of people listen to our podcast and like people like Garrett's like, bro, you've got to come and share your, like I still chuckle at this whole thing, but I know what I'm saying is true because when I say it, men are like, that's true. That's right. Gosh, you're hitting me. Yeah. You know what I mean? So,
And so for you to say that you're not sure how I would perceive the hearing God's voice, so first of all, big believer over here.
Yeah.
So and I think that like God utilizes us as tools in his hands to accomplish a greater work, right? Yeah. Like that's my ultimate belief, that like the reason I've been put on this earth is to go and impact and change and you know, do incredible things amongst millions of lives.
Yeah.
And so like absolutely, like just hearing the message that you're sharing,
yeah,
100% agree that.
Yeah, and it's like that's what it was saying. Any religion, I've got Muslim guys who are like, dude, I heard your podcast, and I was like, I've only been doing one of those dials, and they're like, I'm a 20% man, and even though it doesn't even matter what religion people are or what faith people believe, like this, what I'm saying is just true. Like,
this is the gospel.
I call it the gospel of married game.
Yeah.
And I feel like I'm an evangelist. Like, yeah. And that's the fervor and zeal I have.
Here's the thing. It. Religion doesn't depict truth. Truth is truth.
Yeah, that's right.
Right.
Yeah.
Like in every religion has some aspect of truth.
Yeah.
Some have more than others.
Yeah.
But like you can find truth in everything. So like I'm a big believer that you can't separate your spiritual from your physical, from your economic, from everything. Like if a principle's true or whatnot, like it rings true. So like,
yeah,
absolutely. Amen, like it's going
to, I'm on that mission. I believe God talks to me. I'm here for one thing, and that's to share this with dudes, because regardless of where you go after you die, if you and your wife aren't good while you're here, already feels like hell on earth.
Right.
And like for dudes that are like, we talked about earlier, like if a guy has, and we work with a lot of business dudes, you know what I mean? It's because that's who we are. Like we love business. Like we love freedom. We love independence. If you have radical abundance in every other area of your life except this one, dude, it is, you would give up everything just to have that.
Absolutely.
And I know guys are like, dude, I would give up everything to have my wife actually love me. I go, well, you don't have to do that. All you have to do is become lovable again. Mm-hmm. And let's work on that. So.
So number five.
Dial five. Dial five is the power dial. The power dial. Our society has made men or done its best to try and make men feel bad for being men. And they've been doing it through TV. You got Al Bundy's, you're like, you got Homer Simpson, you got Phil Dunphy. It's like they got the hot wives and this doofus dad.
Right.
And so the power dial is, there's a couple aspects to it, but if I could sum it up with this one statement, to me, it like holds everything. And it's, do what you say you're going to do when you say you're going to do it without fault. Like you do, and you're going to be right 90%, 95%, 99% of the time because you're human. You're going to forget stuff.
Right.
Like we all forget stuff. I'm not perfect, but if I say I'm going to do something, you can, the check is, it's going to clear. But it didn't for a long time. And so what happens is, I'll give you a story. We move into this house, beautiful house, and my wife's like, hey, can you hang this in here and kind of put this stuff here? Mm-hmm. I go, no problem, I'm on it. Week later, she goes, hey, were you good? I'm like, I got it, I'm on it. Don't nag me, I got it. 3 weeks later, she's like, I don't want to be a nag, but, and what I realized is that was a pattern in my life. I would say I would do something. Hey, I'll be here at this time. Not there, super late. Oh, busy at the office. And it's like excuse after excuse after excuse. And what I realized what happens was I started losing her trust. And so where I came up with the phrase, when the trust goes down, the lust goes down.
Mm.
And so she goes, if I can't trust you, I'm starting to build up resentment towards you. How am I supposed to like actually care about your needs and care about your wants and want to do all these freaky things with you when in reality, you don't even live by your code. You don't even live by your word. When you tell me you're going to pick up so-and-so and you forget, and it's not just once in a while, it's like more regular than not, I started to realize that this trust thing was way bigger than I actually believed it was. And so when the trust goes up, the lust goes up. And so most guys are like, I can't believe my wife doesn't want me. She doesn't want to connect with me. And I go, well, do you do what you say you're going to do? Well, of course, my word is my bond. Yeah, except it's not. And what I've discovered is that most men are liars. Like they won't be like, dude, I'm white, when they're like, I'm black. It's not that obvious. It's, dude, you said you're going to be home at a certain time and you weren't, like every day this week.
Right.
And so this particular concept, it also blends well with what we call the mom matrix. The mom matrix is this. Most dudes are doing things to try and get approval and taps on their head from their mom or from their wife. And so the mom matrix is the reason you're doing things is so you can get applause and praise from her, like a cookie or a nookie or a gold star. And so she's like, dude, no moms want to make love to their kids. That's not a thing. You know what I mean? In any state, in any religion, it's not a thing.
Right.
So I was like, a lot of guys would be like, yeah, I've got 3 kids, but my wife says she has 4. And it's like, that's it. That's an indictment about kind of what a POS you are, man. Because she doesn't look at you as the man that keeps his word. So that became like paramount to everything. Now there's a couple other pieces that we work on that is like, do you edit or audit your shine? Meaning, do you change your opinion about things because you're afraid of what she's going to think? And then she realizes, oh, you're basically my dancing bear. You're not trying to upset the apple cart. And for some guys, when they are in a pretty low or sexless relationship, they don't want to upset the apple cart. So they won't even share their opinion because it's Tuesday and they know that Friday is their one time in the month where they're going to get lucky. And they're like, don't say anything this Tuesday. But you know you need to say something as a man, but you don't. And she goes, he's weak. He's afraid of me. He doesn't want to say what he really believes. So they edit or audit what they're saying around here, and they talk differently around their guys. Nobody likes that. Nobody respects that. So she loses respect. They've been rejected so much that they won't ask for it anymore. And if they do ask for it, they get pouty when they get rejected. Mm. Or they start getting, well, if I got more of this around the house, then maybe I would do more around the house. And they're like, oh, back to transaction again. So it's like, do you do your personal development for her? And do you get butthurt if she doesn't notice, or do you do it for you? So we have a phrase in Married Game that says, her response does not dictate my standard.
Right.
My standard is my standard.
Yep.
I'm going to be this guy. I'm going to make this money. I'm going to show up this way. I'm going to have this body. I'm going to talk this way because that's the standard I set for myself. And she wants somebody that has a high standard that doesn't deviate based on her moods up or down or what time of the month it is. She's like, that guy is our solid rock. We call it being a redwood.
Nice, nice.
Immovable.
I've actually heard it put this way, and it's something that I've shared with a lot of married guys, is it's like the goal is to get to 100%, right? And too often we look at it like, I got to bring my 50 and they bring their 50, mm-hmm. right? So it's like a 50-50 relationship, add up to get to 100, where really the goal should be, I got to bring 100 and not care whether she brings anything. Yeah. Right? Yeah. Like it's the same thing,
for
right?
A while, for a time.
For a time, but...
You got to be 100
first. But what I'm saying is like without expectation of reciprocation. Yeah,
exactly.
Right? And because otherwise it's transactional. I did my 50, where's your 50 at to get to 100? And if you don't bring your 50 when I brought my 50, then, you know, then we're sitting half full or whatever. So,
exactly.
Yeah, it's interesting. So what, man, so these are the 5... What is the best? I mean, what do you see guys working on first?
Okay, well, so when we call them dials, because I love rock and roll, that's why I got guitars and you know, all this. So I look at it like, think of an amplifier. If these things are all cranked up to as close as 10 as possible, we call that a man becoming a provocateur. And a provocateur is a man that provokes his wife to want him, to lust after him. It's like, she goes, I can't help it. And this is what's crazy. A lot of guys, when they come into our program, within the first week or two, their wives are like, man, I feel like I'm with my boyfriend again. What happened? What's going on here? And so that's what we want. We want it to be natural for her to be like it was in the beginning. That's what every guy wants. I want it like it was for beginning. So we have a thesis, and it's something that we believe. We think honeymoon sex is for minor leaguers, and that soul sex gets better with age. Hmm. We just celebrated our 12th anniversary. It was the greatest night her and I have ever had in our entire existence of being married. It was my greatest night I've ever had, even though I've been with a lot of women. That was the number one night ever.
Amen.
12 years later. So we believe if we're both getting better, it should get better.
Right.
So I just reject the narrative that the first 2 years are the best and then everything goes down from here. What a horribly hopeless existence. So these are like concepts and frames that we really lean into.
Right.
And another concept is go spend 90 days cleaning your side of the street. Don't ask for anything. Hmm. Just go have your street. We call it being above reproach. Be so dang awesome that she's like, I got nothing to say except you're amazing. Like, get in here.
Right.
So what is the guy, what do most guys do first? Well, first of all, usually the player and power dial are where they go, ugh, dang, dude, my dates suck. I'm the guy that did the Home Depot and the Chick-fil-A.
Right.
So they start amping that up. They start, another where they start is like, we need to have giver energy, not taker energy. So if you're doing something just to get something, that's a taker energy. Guy or girl, we hate takers.
Right.
We love givers. So have a reputation with yourself and with others that's a giver.
Nice.
That person gives. So that's where I would start.
So start from a conscious level of I'm just in this to give. I don't care what I'm going to receive in response.
And have your, I call it the reputation of yourself. What is the reputation? My reputation of myself is I do what I say I'm going to do without fault. Like, I'm going to do that. I forgot to bring dinner home the other night. I was at one of my favorite places getting tacos, and my wife texts me. She goes, hey, can you bring it home? I'm like, no problem.
Right.
I get home. They're so excited. Like, do you got it? I'm like, oh, I don't. I totally forgot. I'll go back. They're like, no. Don't worry. Even my daughter's like, Dad, like, you never forget stuff. Like, so it was an anomaly. It was like they were shocked that I didn't do it. And they're like, no problem. We'll just order Postmates. It's not even a big deal. I'm like, guys, I feel horrible. They're like, well, this is like once in like the last 200 times that you said you knew something, you didn't do it. So we just like giggled.
Yeah, it's still okay to make mistakes.
Well, I'm human. Like, right. What do you expect? You know what I mean? And then when they make a mistake, I just like, that's no promise. We're human. Mm. So this is it's such simple stuff, man. I feel like a lot of times I go, you remember the person that put a rock in a box and sold it as the pet rock? That's what I feel like I'm doing. It's so dang simple.
You're taking the
basic
principles that most people understand to some level.
Yeah.
But that's the reality of frameworks, right? Yeah. Frameworks, when you break down what are potentially complex issues, I mean, because when you're going through something like this, mm-hmm. it feels complex, right? Right? Like trying to figure out a wife, right? Yeah, you can cut the awkwardness in the air or whatever it may be. And so you take that complex issue and you dumb it down to something like super basic, like this. And I think it's absolutely incredible. I love what you talked about as far as like in order to make the change, you got to change your identity, like what you, your self-perception of you.
Yeah.
Right? Like James Clear talks about in Atomic Habits.
Oh, so
like
good.
The number one motivator in changing a habit is if you change your identity.
Yeah.
Right? Like it's not that I no longer smoke. It's I'm not a smoker.
Yeah.
Right? That's not who I am. And when you can change your identity, you begin to act in accordance to who you perceive yourself as.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How many people have told you look like Chris Pratt?
Chris Pratt? I don't know. Not many.
No?
Yeah.
Dude, I've been getting Pratt vibes this entire
Pratt
time.
Pratt vibes?
Yeah, all Pratt right. vibes.
I'll take it. That's good.
I love it, man.
Sweet, man. So awesome. You have this awesome framework. Where's the best way for people to engage with you and start like participating in your program? Books? What do you got?
Marriedgame.com.
Marriedgame.com.
If they go to marriedgame.com, there's a 25-minute video there where I kind of explain and I kind of hit it from different angles. They'll have the opportunity if they want to jump on. I don't have a sales team. I do the calls. That's just how I built this thing exactly the way I want to build it. And or on my Instagram, we have reels going on. I probably have 400 reels ready to go that are 90 seconds of just boom, 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 that stuff like this, but or crazy stories, or to go to the Married Game podcast, and they can consume over 100 episodes of me and my wife laughing at each other for all the stupid stuff we've done.
Well, dude, man, this is like very helpful. I think like you said, I mean, this is the message that God has put in your heart to go and share with the world. And I think it is very applicable. I mean, each one of us, we're all going through it.
Yeah.
In some level or another. None of us are tens all the time.
Yeah, neither am I.
Right.
Yeah.
And so it's like figuring out that. What are some like books or resources that have like inspired you along the way?
I love reading, as you can tell by my library. I read every single day. I hate to be this guy, but there's not really, like, the books about learning game are usually written for single guys.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. I'll say one good book that I recommend everybody in our group is The No More Mr. Nice Guy by Robert Glover. Most guys, they struggle from being a nice guy, which means, I'm not saying don't be nice, but their motivation for being nice is to get something. Mm. And that book seems to really hit the angle of why that is. But everything else that's written about this stuff seems to be, it's manipulative and angled. And I don't think that that's good. So I don't really know. My book's coming out soon that I think is
excited.
Going. Yeah, that I'm gonna hit this angle, because I feel very like I'm one of guys saying it from this angle. So well, I know that might sound a little.
Where's the best place to find you on Instagram?
What's
your Instagram handle?
At Keith Yackey.
At Keith Yackey, guys, Founder Nation. If you're not following Keith, give him a follow. This guy's full of incredible knowledge. He's going to improve your sex life, your relationship, make you, what is the name?
A provocateur.
A provocateur. Man, I want to be a provocateur.
Who doesn't want to be a provocateur? Dude, especially since the fruit of being a provocateur feels so good.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Oh, man, I think there's nothing better. I mean, the phrase happy wife, happy life is a reality. And to make her happy is, I mean, being that provocateur.
Exactly. That's what makes her really happy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I love it. Sweet. Thank you so much for your time. It's been a freaking phenomenal time just hanging out. Thank you for letting me use your studio and hanging out here in beautiful Orange County.
Yeah. Thanks for having me on the show, man. Like, it's an honor. It's an honor. Anybody that takes an interest in what we're saying, I'm deeply honored and humbled by it.
I love it. What's last piece of advice that you would give outside of these five things to somebody that is struggling with a relationship? Like, what is like some just core piece of advice that you give to them?
I would want to give them hope, because most guys feel stuck and hopeless. They're like, listen, I don't want to get a divorce. I don't want to split up my family. There's many reasons why people don't want to get a divorce, whether it's religious or not religious. They're like, dude, I don't want to split up my family. I don't want to go down that road again. But they feel stuck and in prison, and they don't know what to actually do. And I just hope that they would have hope that a guy like me, who's my story, who's been through the deepest, darkest pit, I know those tunnels really well, and I hope that they know that they're not alone. That's the other thing is, most men think they don't talk about this with their dudes, because nobody is like, yeah, I'm not getting, you know what I mean? It's like 85% of dudes are actually going through this. You're not alone. So I'd want them to know that you're not alone. You have hope, and hopefully this resource and me sharing what I've shared and you sharing and letting me share this on your platform, I just want them to have hope. It's not done. It's not over. And there really is a solution to this.
I love it. Thank you so much, Keith. Until next time.